better to invest more time and money on an experiment to test a new technology in the early phases of the project, or to accelerate as much as possible the first project phases to gain knowledge about what to do and still have time to do it? To give a proper answer to questions like this one, we need a model for supporting our decisions. And to do so, we will start with a conceptual model representing how every project functions. At first, we can think of a project as an array of decisions to be made. This comes directly from the project definition. Projects are managerial tools to obtain unique and novel outputs. Being the output new, the sequence and the content of the activities to be performed will be new as well. Thus, a crucial step will be to make decisions about things to do, like what, when, who, how, where, and so on. Let's consider the project for the development of a new car, for example. There will be thousands of decisions to be made. Is it an SUV, a convertible, a sedan? Is the power coming from an electric, hybrid, or petrol engine? What color will the instrument panel light be? Some of these decisions will be trivial, or at least it will be simple to change them. Some others will have a high impact on the project, and they will hardly be questioned and changed in the later phases. It is even more critical, though, to underline that these will not be stand-alone decisions. Instead, they are heavily interconnected, and this is one of the primary sources of complexity for projects. Consider, for example, that one of the early decisions is to design a convertible car. Once the decision is made, it will be hardly changed, and many other decisions will have to cope with it in the future. Some months later, the engineer designing the car interior will have many constraints coming from this decision. When deciding where positioning the buttons for the electric windows, for example, she will have to avoid putting them on the overhead panel. We can learn from this simple example that every time we make a decision on a project, we create constraints, but also opportunities, for other decisions we will make later on along the project. The interrelation between decisions that we just described is normally among different phases. But there are also other types of interdependence between project decisions. An example is an interdependency between different parts of the output. According to this, decisions made in a part of a project might require to modify the decision of other parts contextually. Considering the example of a car, if the team dealing with the engine's development makes substantial changes, then the team taking care of the electronics or the chassis will have to take this into account by adapting their part of the project. Finally, there will be a possible interdependency between projects, according to which some project decisions could even impact on other projects. For example, let's imagine the case of a company that is trying to solve a logistic problem, and to do so, decides to acquire an ERP system, Enterprise Resource Planning. The company will evaluate different vendors and will eventually select one of them. From that moment on, all the other projects that will be done in the company will no longer have a possibility to decide and will have to adapt to the ERP that was initially selected. We saw that the project can be modeled as an array of interdependent decisions, and that making a mistake might cause a domino effect. But what are the negative effects that we might expect because of a mistake? Well, the first and worst thing that can happen is usually called a recycle. We have a recycle when we discover that all the constraints created by previous decisions left an empty decisional space at a certain point of a project. This means that there is no way to move on with a project. The only two options are going back to change a previous decision, with all the impacts on time and cost to change what has already been done, or abandon the project. For example, in a project to develop a new lamp, we may fail in passing the safety test for commercialization. Such a product can't be launched on the market unless we go back to change one or more of the previous decisions and all the related activities since then. A second thing that can happen if we make a mistake in making a decision is usually called a complication of the next activities. It is less severe, but can still impact the project time and cost. The starting situation is similar to a recycle, but in this case, the decisional space left by previous decision is not completely empty. Some decisions can still be made, but they are all suboptimal and will negatively impact the project performances. This is the case of design problems that can be solved post the production phase. Think about the same lamp we discussed before. And imagine that after redesigning a component, which is a recycle, we now discover that adapting the assembly line would be too expensive. So we decide to assemble the old, not compliant version and then change the component at the end of a production line. In this case, we are adding new activities to the production phase, with consequences on the project cost and time. The third and final effect of wrong decisions on a project impacts the quality performance and not the cost and time. In many cases, we find we made a mistake, but solving it, either by going back, recycle, or patching it, complication of future activities, appears to be more expensive than just deteriorating the quality and the value of the output. This is also known as de-scoping, and often occurs when time and budget are over and we decide to release an output that does not fulfill the initial project scope. Obviously, this will harm the project value, but this loss in value might be lower than the cost to fix the problem.